Hello and welcome to People's Dispatch. Today, we're joined by Dr. Taimur Rehman, the General Secretary of the Pakistan Mazdoor Kisan Party and one of the key members of the revolutionary music band Lal. Hello, Taimur. Thanks for joining us.
Hi. Thank you for inviting me.
Could we first start by talking about the political situation in Pakistan right now? So it's been a couple of months since the Imran Khan government came to power, and this was seen as the beginning of a new era. Mm. It's breaking the two-party system after a long time. So how do you assess the politics and the performance of the government, especially in the context of what this means, its relation to the military and issues like that?
Well, I think the performance of the government has been absolutely dismal. And I think the people of Pakistan have come to realize it themselves. Right. It's not just an opinion that I have, it's a widespread public opinion. And the main reason for that is that the cost of living has been going up rapidly for the last 9 months. Right. And simultaneously, the rupee has been devaluing relative to the dollar. And development projects and other forms of capital investment have slowed down. And some of the reasons have to do with the overall structure of dependency in which Pakistan, within the context of the international political economy.
Right.
But part of the reasons have to do with just the general incompetence of the government itself. Mm-hmm. And the third aspect is that the government has been trying, but very unsuccessfully, to catch people who've been engaging in corrupt activities.
Right.
The result has been, on the one hand, that they haven't managed to catch anyone that really, or they have caught only a few people who have been engaging in corruption activities, but simultaneously, that of course has caused both capital to become anxious about investing, and it's also caused a slowdown in government development projects at the same time.
Right.
What is really most interesting in this scenario is that while we in the left have been talking about the rising cost of living and the impact that this has had on the people of Pakistan and how every promise that the PTI has made, it has abandoned or it has taken a U-turn on it.
Right.
It's completely gone in the opposite direction. Mm-hmm. But what is really much more interesting than that is that if we were to accept that Imran Khan and his team really came with really great intentions, that they will in fact do away with corruption, which is of course eating away at the way capital works itself.
Right.
We come to realize that within the context of the way in which Pakistan and many other third world countries are fitted into the global political economy, governments really have very little choice but
exactly
to follow the diktat of the International Monetary Fund.
Right.
We import more than we export. There's a massive trade deficit, as a consequence of which we have to make up that trade deficit from one avenue or another.
Right.
So we're forced to borrow. And when you borrow, then you have to meet the terms and conditions of the people that you're borrowing from.
Right. And in this context, Pakistan is getting a $6 billion bailout from the IMF.
Correct.
And what do you see as the implications of this move, as in what is Pakistan likely to surrender?
The implications are really very, very bad. First, let me just fill your viewers in on an interesting little detail there. The economics and finance minister of the government of Pakistan was fired just before the conclusion of this contract with the International Monetary Fund. His name is Asad Umar, and he happens to be a long-time supporter of the PTI, which was not just a supporter, a leader of the PTI, you know, since the party was really very, very small.
Right.
And in his place, you know, we have people who are advising the government, people like Hafiz Sheikh and people who were working with the International Monetary Fund, currently employed by the International Monetary Fund, have moved to become the governor of State Bank and so on. Now, what everyone is saying is this is like the IMF negotiating with the IMF because, you know, you have someone who was just till, you know, a few days ago an employee of the IMF, now moving into the government of Pakistan and negotiating on behalf of the government of Pakistan. It's quite insane.
Right.
More importantly, there are certain things that cannot change in the way in which the budget is allocated. Let's look at the Pakistani budget. No politician to this date has ever managed to negotiate with the military establishment what proportion or how much money the military will or will not get.
Right.
That is something the military demands and the civilian government mostly complies. Mm-hmm. So that part of the budget is really unmovable.
Right.
The other part of the budget that's completely unmovable is the expenditure that the government of Pakistan has to make on debt resurfacing from previous loans, etc. And so therefore, in order to now to save money, to improve the budget deficit, the portion of the budget that has to be cut is the development expenditures. That has to be cut and so on. And third, and that you can imagine, cannot have a positive impact on the growth of the economy. It has the opposite impact because, you know, you're sort of winding down the government sector, and it's not necessary that the private sector is going to invest in sufficient quantity to offset that.
Right.
Last but not least, no government has managed, owing to the way in which the class politics of Pakistan works, no government has managed really to implement a proper income tax. Although it's there on paper, but they're just not able to implement it. What that means is that the government is making the vast majority of its tax revenue through indirect taxes, which disproportionately affect the poor. So now you begin to see the overall scenario.
Exactly right.
That you're sort of taking money from the lower middle class, the middle class, you're contracting your development expenditures that you know that the government is making. There is no change, there is a growth in fact in the amount that you're spending on the military and in debt resurfacing. And so the overall impact of all of this is an enormous rise in the cost of living. And the destruction of the incomes of working people and their life savings, the plummeting of the economy as a whole within the international market,
right,
and no signs of coming out of this dark tunnel so far.
So to take a step back, how exactly do you see the class character of the Pakistani state itself? I mean, there is the aspect of the military, of course, and the various political power, which has played a very important role in its polity so far. And there's a Pakistani bourgeois in a particular stage of development. So how, from a leftist perspective, do you see that character itself?
That's an excellent question. I mean, we've looked at, from within the Pakistani Marxist intelligentsia, we have people like Hamza Alvi and others who've spoken about argued the case for the overdeveloped post-colonial state. And that seems to be the framework that most Pakistani Marxists also operate with. So basically, the state is essentially bourgeois. It is essentially part of the world capitalist system. Its logic of operation, its thought process is all very much centered on capital.
Right.
There is also, of course, a very large class of people, which is the landowning class, which emerges from the Jagirdari system. And you can call them semi-bourgeois, semi-capitalist, and semi... we use the term feudal in South Asia, but I actually don't really like that feudal. I prefer landed class, right? Landlords. The main reason is that we have some distinctions from European feudalism. For South Asia versus Europe. So that is the mix. But in the history of Pakistan, the configuration has been such that when Pakistan was created, the bourgeoisie was actually very weak. So at that time, and it didn't, and the party that existed, the Muslim League, which was meant to become the bourgeois party, fractured into many, many small, you know, sort of parts. So Ayub Khan took over, and when he took over, he sort of handpicked 22 families, and then gave them sort of monopolistic control over their own sectors, right, and built them up. And the idea then was that if we have this sort of functional inequality, you'll hit 6% rate of growth, and if you hit that, then it'll trickle down to some future point, okay, and so on and so forth. This whole nonsense that was being taught at the time. And, you know, Papanek, Gustav Papanek and Samuel Huntington were advising the Pakistani government and saying this is absolutely great. The result of that is that the bourgeoisie of Pakistan developed in a very peculiar way. It developed in the way that it was very much part of state capital, and state capital was very much used. State monopoly capitalism was very much used to support it, to develop it, to encourage it, for it to become profitable.
Right.
That's why the bourgeoisie of Pakistan, although it's a well-developed class, it has its sort of, you know, there's industry and it has its points of views and it has its institutions, its newspapers, the whole thing. But it's very much tied to state capital. It's very much tied to the state. And by state here, I mean, of course, the military establishment, which is central. So the bourgeoisie itself, a big portion of the bourgeoisie itself, prefers, in the context of Pakistan, to have military dictatorship rather than to have elections and to have bourgeois democracy.
Right.
And I think we are familiar enough, we ought to be familiar enough enough with history to realize that the bourgeoisie all over the globe actually has not never preferred to have universal franchise, but preferred to have a republic in which they, you know, they would not necessarily be under the monarchy, but they never really wanted to give working people the right to vote.
Right.
They preferred that arrangement. It was the Chartists and other working class, you know, and then the Paris Commune that forced the bourgeoisie to institute, and of course the Russian Revolution that forced the bourgeoisie to institute universal franchise. So in the context of Pakistan as well, so you see that the main sectors of the bourgeoisie say, let's have the military. They're just so much more efficient. It's so much more easier. There's a few people to deal with, and you know, they do what we need them to do, and it's much better. That's what the vast majority says. But recently, a change has started to come about. That helps us understand the dynamics of what has happened recently. And that is that parts of the bourgeoisie have been arguing now the case for civilian rule as opposed to military rule.
Right.
And that would be Nawaz Sharif, firstly. It would also be Asif Zardari, you know, to a very large extent, and many other sort of arrangements, similar people. So that has caused, you know, not only have they been advocating that, you know, those who are elected by the people ought to be in government, but they've also been advocating that the military be confined to its constitutional role. This has caused the pushback. So, and there are several questions on which this has sort of emerged. One was the question of, one is always the question of how to deal with India, what's going on in Kashmir, should we have good relations with India, should we have trade with India, what sort of relations we should have with India. So on that front, the military would like to be consulted first and foremost. In fact, it would like to call the shots and then consult the civilian administration. The civilian administration would like to do it the other way around. The second issue that caused the difference between Mian Nawaz Sharif and the military establishment was over the question of religious extremism.
Mm-hmm.
There was a few very important incidents in which certain reports were leaked in the press about meetings between the civilian administration and the military establishment, and the way in which that was reported war really upset the military establishment. And they believed that the civilian government was responsible for the way in which it was reported in the mainstream news. So overall, that it is our understanding that that has caused the military establishment to say, we are no longer going to be supporting the Muslim League or the PPP anymore, or we're going to try and build a third option. And that's why it's been argued by Dawn and many other newspapers, in fact, by Geo Dawn and many other papers and many other writers, that the military establishment has been building up Imran Khan through the mainstream media and brought him to power, where his real control even today is largely with the military too. So that's the scenario. And so they sort of want to, and the military also has moved against the MQM, against the PPP, as well as against the PML. This is the case being made. So it seems like the military wants that there should be, I mean, the case being made in the Pakistani media from the from this side of the story is that the military wants to sort of get rid of the old established politicians and bring up a new crop of politicians that would
more amenable to them,
who are more amenable to their views. Of course, that it never works that way, to be honest, because the current crop of politicians was also at one point brought by the, you know, supported by the military establishment against another group of politicians who at that time were recalcitrant or whatever, you know. So it never works that way.
Thank you, Taimur. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching People's Dispatch.